Before we go into the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are certain principles that we need to understand relating to the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And point number one is that the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are tawqifiyya. And this means that us as the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we cannot come up with any names for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from our intellect. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shut the door for insan, for man, using their intellect to draft names for himself. And this is because we have never seen Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, laysa kamithlihi shay. So nobody should practice ijtihad regarding the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and saying, according to my opinion, I've drafted this name and I think this name is a good name for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No. This means that we need tawqifiyya, basically means that we, whenever we give Allah or call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by a name, it has to be confirmed in the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in terms of his hadith. So this is the first point, and it is a very interesting and important point. Point number two, can we draft names from the descriptions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described himself with? And this relates to the Quran and the Sunnah. So in certain verses in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes his attributes. Are we allowed to draft a name for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from his description? And the scholars, they have differed on this. I can give you an example. Allah has described himself as the giver of life and the giver of death, al-muhyi and al-mumit. So are we allowed to name Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-muhyi al-mumit based on these two descriptions? The scholars, they have two different views. The first group of scholars, they say no, you can't draft a name for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the descriptions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. And the reason for this is point number one, that the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are tawqifiyya. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him a name, we have to make sure that when we use it, there is sound evidence for it. The other group, they say, you can draft a name from the descriptions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because the description is the implication of the name. However, there is an exception to this rule. And this exception is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in certain places in the Quran, he describes himself taking actions. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. They plotted and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also plotted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best of plotters or the best of planners. So can we call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can we name Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the plotter? And both parties, those who agree that you can give a name from the descriptions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those who say you can't, both of them agree that you can't name Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the plotter. So the ones that are asking for the evidence, that's quite straightforward. They've rejected this because they say that you can't take the name from a description. However, what about those who say you can draft a name for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the description? And the reason these scholars, they say you're not allowed to use the word plotter, is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah, he has used the word plotter, an action, specifically to a specific situation. And the reason behind this situation was that it was to fix those who were plotting against the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they were ridiculing him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has taken this action in a specific sense. The instant is specific, and it doesn't mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continually plots. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-basir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-seeing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as-sami'. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all-hearing. The descriptions that we draft names for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have to be perpetual in their qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heart. And if we say, you know, mashallah, the heart is a beautiful form of engineering, let's call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the engineer. Are we allowed to call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the engineer? A quick yes, no from the students. Okay, the correct answer is no, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, although he is the creator, the fashioner of the heart, he has not referred to himself as the engineer. So this is the second point. We'll move on to the third point. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's almighty names are from changeable and no fixed words. So getting a little bit technical here, Allah's names are from derivatives, and derivatives are from root words. So for example, there's names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are Al-Ghaffar, Al-Ghafur, and Al-Ghafir. So these all come from the same root, Ghafara. Al-Ghaffar, Al-Ghafur, Al-Ghafir, Ghafara. And when we look at these names, are these classed as three separate names, or are they classed as one name? Can you type one or three for your answers, please? Okay, a couple of ones, but I think the majorities are three. So the correct answer is indeed three. And the reason for this is because each name has a special meaning. So although they are derived from the root of Ghafara, they are three separate names and they have three special meanings. So in the count of the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will be counted as three. At the same time, we need to understand that there are certain names that come together. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Qabid, which means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala withholds. But this name has to be joined with Al-Basit. Al-Qabid and Al-Basit. Al-Qabid means the one who withholds, and Al-Basit is the one who extends. And this is to do justice to these names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if we say Al-Qabid on its own, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala withholds, this is not doing justice to the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not withholding because he does not have the ability to do so. Rather, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is withholding because of a wisdom only he himself knows. So the names Al-Qabid and Al-Basit, would they be counted as one name or two names in the count of the 99 names? Getting a lot of twos. Okay, the correct opinion is that they should be classed as one name because they go together and they complement each other. As I mentioned, that if we just say Al-Qabid, and some people, they might think Al-Qabid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who withholds. But when you say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Qabid and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Basit, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has the ability to withhold, and he is the one who has the ability to extend. These two names together, they complement each other. Finally, point number four, we need to understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's name in the most elevated of ways. The Arabic term Al-Mathalu Al-A'la. And this principle, it teaches us that we need to understand the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the most highest form possible, the most elevated of forms, and not by comparing the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the creation. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Laysa kamithlihi shay. And I gave you an example here that you can name your child Rahim. We mentioned it is the etiquettes of being humble and respectful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we name the child Abdur Rahim, servant of Rahim, rather than Rahim itself. But you can't compare your child's Rahim, mercy and kindness, to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to really drive this point home, when we think of Jannah, we think about the trees of Jannah, the houses of Jannah, the streams of Jannah, the milk in Jannah, the lush green grass in Jannah. But the description that has been given about Jannah is that whatever we think about Jannah, and we think of our dream home in Jannah, it's always going to be hundreds and thousands of times better than what we could ever imagine. Because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that the mind cannot comprehend, the eyes cannot have never seen before, and the ears have never heard anything like this. So if I was to ask you, do you know what a tree is? Everybody will say naturally, yes, they know what a tree is. But when we say, can you describe a tree in Jannah? We can say there is going to be a tree in Jannah, and there are some descriptions that, you know, the tree is going to be so large that it will, the shade of the tree, I think a person on a horse could be traveling in the shade of that tree for around 500 years. But we don't know how the tree is going to be. So similarly, the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are exclusive to Him. They are unlike the creation. And when we think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need to think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the most elevated of ways. Okay, moving on. Hadith on the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions in the hadith of Bukhari, and it's also mentioned in many other beautiful hadith. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ تِسْعَةً وَتِسْعِينَ إِسْمًا مِئَةً إِلَّا وَاحِدًا مَنْ أَحْصَاهَا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he narrated that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Allah has 99 names, i.e. 100 minus 1, and whoever knows them will go to paradise. So this is a beautiful hadith. It's authentic in its virtue. And at this point, I want to open up the floor and ask the question, does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only have 99 names, or are they more than 99 names? I've seen all no's apart from one yes. So the question is, does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only have 99 names? Okay, there's some yeses, there's some no's, there's a bit of confusion in the class. We might need to call a friend in a few minutes' time. So the correct answer is that there are more than 99 names. And I shared with you a dua for distress and grief when I sent out the notes for this lecture. And I'll read the hadith. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there is no one who is afflicted by distress and grief and reads the following dua, but Allah would take away his distress and grief and replace it with joy. He was asked, O Messenger of Allah, should we learn this? He said, of course, everyone who hears it should learn it. So this is a dua that inshallah you can learn in your own times. Allahumma inni abduka wa ibnu abdik وابن أمتك ناصيتي بيدك ماض في حكمك عدل في قضاؤك أسألك بكل اسم هو لك سميت به نفسك أو علمته أحدا من خلقك أو أنزلته في كتابك أو استأثرت به في علم الغيب عندك أن تجعل القرآن ربيع قلبي ونور صدري وجلاء حزني وذهاب همي. And I just want to draw your attention, this is also an authentic hadith, I want to draw your attention to the line where the dua is basically asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by every name belonging to Him which you have named yourself with, or which you revealed in your book, or which you taught to any of your creation, or which you have preserved in the knowledge of the unseen with you. So this, or you have preserved in the knowledge of the unseen with you, confirms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has more than 99 names. And to drive the point home again, if I said that Yusuf has £1,000 which he has left on the side for charity, does this mean that he only has £1,000 for charity, or he has more money? Yeah. So this is similarly, from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the scholars, they mention that this there is a special number of 99 names that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, and they are special in rank and special in status. These are like the elite names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now everybody wants to ask, must be thinking of the question, well, the 99 names of Allah, and many of you may have seen on posters that you know, there's 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he didn't mention the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The companions and our scholars, our predecessors, they have made an attempt, to write these names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the same hadith, it comes in Jami' al-Tirmidhi, and the person narrating the hadith, he has written a list of 99 names. So some of the scholars, they dispute this hadith, because what they say is that the hadith was narrated in its authentic form, and then the author, the narrator of hadith, he made a list of the 99 names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from his research and discussion with his teachers. And when the hadith was passed down, it was passed down like it is coming as a saying of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in relation to this hadith, there is a difference of opinion amongst the scholars. I do have a list of names which the major scholars have agreed on. I think there's about 85 or 84 names in there's about 85 or 84 names which are authentic and which the scholars have agreed upon, the major scholars. So inshallah, I will share this list with you all.